So I would like to thank the organizers to invite me and to address the matter of all or nothing, which worries me more and more. For 20 years now, I have been a vegan and promoted and facilitated this beneficial way of life. But unfortunately, I'm now witnessing a damaging number of conflicts about the best way forward. This disagreement slows progress down in many places and often even stops it altogether. The interest of the animals, we all need to do our best to end their brutal exploitation as soon as possible and not allow any more disagreements to waste precious energy and scarce resources. It is also important to find out why we still have to justify our refusal to eat animals. After all, nobody will be asked why he or she only buys organic foods and rejects child labor, so why does turning away from animal products demand an explanation? Obviously, the idea of animal rights has not yet reached general public awareness. We are living in a time of growing polarization. On the one side are those for whom it is natural that animals are not to be killed and tortured. On the other side are those who do not care about the consequences of their actions. The development confronts us with the absurd situation that the rejection of animal cruelty still needs to be explained. Moreover, meat eaters tend to disapprove of those who value the lives of animals higher than questionable culinary delights and condemn them as outsiders or even as extremists. I'm sure that each one of us has already been asked whether it would not be better to do something for people instead of animals. It is a fact that quite often those who want to know are people who are not really interested in their humans, either humans nor animals, but still need to be told that our work for animals does not exclude effective help for people. On the contrary, firstly, many activists are assisting by all being in distress, and secondly, does a more responsible treatment of animal beings bring considerable progress for the human society at the same time? Or, as Bradley Miller says, teaching a child not to step on a caterpillar is as important for the child as for the caterpillar. How can this growing gap in perception be bridged so that animals are finally perceived as sentient beings and treated accordingly by all? There are broad agreement between welfarists, vegetarians, vegans, animal rights activists, abolitionists that animals must not be considered as property and that they have their own right to live. Furthermore, we generally agree on the urgency to improve their fate. However, there is no consensus about how to achieve such fundamental change in society. Many of the abolitionists have split off from other activists and criticized their efforts for a better life for the so-called livestock, a silent endorsement of the continued enslaving of our fellow beings. They consider vegetarians as animal abusers who refuse to give up the consumption of all animal products. Unfortunately, at the same time, they ignore the fact that vegetarians do not eat meat or fish, which would be the correct definition of vegetarianism, and are instead just concentrating on the negative, even though they themselves, as vegans, are part of the group of vegetarians, because vegans don't eat meat either. They condemn efforts for more animal welfare as a betrayal because animal exploitation is not explicitly called into question in the strive for more human conditions as a next step. In a way, this anger is understandable because the liberation of animals from slavery is indeed far too slow. However, it is also a fact that the purity of doctrine cannot always be implemented 100% and immediately. This dilemma has also become clear to many people and organizations that during the last two decades I saw coming and going with great optimism and the confidence to change the world within a few months. Unfortunately, such unrealistic expectations are often accompanied by a slightly disdainful attitude toward those organizations who have already been active in this field for a long time. Due to this lack of cooperation, many activists got burned out. Money was wasted and the image of animal rights activists tainted in public. Such conflicts are in the way of constructive cooperation because mutual condemnation, criticism and even more division weaken the movement and harm the animals. Of course, the meat industry is delighted about this disharmony because it is well known that their activities can only be slowed down by resolute and professionally organized resistance. So what is the best and fastest approach to reach our common goal and end animal suffering? It is important to distinguish what the goal is and what the best way to achieve it can be. Nobody is going to complain when the number of rape cases is halved in a given country. Even so, hardly anyone would consider this as the final accomplishment of the mission, which is no rape at all. So if a goal cannot be achieved right away, the second best thing is the attempt to get closer to it day by day. Refusing interim results as reprehensible may have some philosophical appeal, but is hurting the target. Had the feminists rejected all intermediate steps because only immediate and complete equality of women and men was on their radar, they would not even have achieved the right to vote today. The demand, all or nothing, is blocking progress, which can best be attained gradually and through persistent education and pragmatic initiatives. Intermediary stages are often indispensable also from a psychological perspective. To ask people to consume only vegan, organic, fair trade food for the rest of their lives carries the risk of overwhelming them so much that they refuse all changes. They simply consider such demand as too extreme. However, a step-by-step method for improving their way of life can bring much more success, especially when it is combined with support and guidance. We also must ask ourselves, what is of more use to the animals? Either to change one single meat eater into a pure vegan consuming only organic food, or within the same period of time and with the same energy successfully guiding 100 meat eaters to a mainly plant-based vegetarian diet? The mere reduction of meat consumption cannot be the target for animal rights activists because it is still condoning the killing of animals for culinary satisfaction. Moreover, such a campaign is virtually ineffective because hardly anyone takes notice. Most people think that they eat very little meat anyway and consider little meat as just the amount they are buying. Fortunately, there are easy intermediate levels before adopting vegetarian and vegan diets, which can facilitate the transition for many. The Vegetarian Day, which enjoys fast-growing popularity and is launched in more and more cities and companies, is a particularly good example. This campaign is an important step in the right direction because it leads to a great number of meatless dishes being sold additionally. It also allows chefs to gain experience in the delicious vegetarian cuisine, which consequently adds more meatless choices on the menu for the rest of the week. Guests also get the possibility to overcome fears of not so familiar meals. They are likely to take an interest in this type of food, discuss it with others, and perhaps even question the consumption of all animal products. It is important to clearly formulate each intermediate step and how it should be put into practice. So instead of just suggesting a diffuse reduction of meat consumption, the promotion of a specific meat-free day per week is more helpful. This intermediate level is easily accessible and can also bring the needed motivation for further steps. Some argue that the promotion of a vegetarian day a week is equivalent with the promotion of 6 meat days per week. This is a negative approach because this is not part of the Veggie Day campaign, which says nothing about the remaining 6 days of the week. There is no reason for vegans to oppose the Veggie Day because on that particular day, they themselves don't eat meat and therefore automatically take part in the campaign. Obviously, the main target of the Veggie Day campaign are the meat eaters, not the vegans. An intermediate step does not only mean getting closer to the goal, but it also allows people to try alternatives out just for a limited period. The Veggie Day campaign represents a perfect combination of both strategies, to work toward a vegan life by suggestion one vegan day per week to begin with. Another alternative is to be vegan only for a certain period, after which can be decided what the best diet will be for the future. Such a gradual process can reduce a lot of pressure because not everyone wants to make an immediate decision for the rest of his life. Also, the promotion of vegetarianism is an important aspect in creating awareness for animal rights. This means primarily to provide solid information helping concerned people to switch to a healthy vegetarian diet. Especially in Switzerland, the first step toward a vegetarian diet is much easier than to a vegan way of life. Dairy products are the food group most consumed by Swiss people. Due to very high subsidies for these animal products, the food industry uses them for a great number of products, which makes dropping dairy consumption much more difficult than giving up meat. The promotion of a vegetarian diet completely respects the animal rationale, since vegetarianism is defined by the fact that no animal's body is eaten, whereas the consumption of dairy or eggs has nothing to do with the definition of a vegetarian lifestyle. Any suggestion of substituting meat by dairy products would be a mistake, not only from the perspective of animal rights, but also for health reasons. However, to invite people to replace meat by healthy plant food, as does the Swiss Vegetarian Union, definitely reduce the animal suffering and should be promoted by all animal rights activists. There are many examples in history where great social changes were gradually achieved. Even slavery was not abolished immediately. First, there were groups fighting only against the capture of slaves in Africa. In the second phase, protests against slaves' ownership followed, and then also economic arguments against slavery were put forward. Finally, all these elements together resulted in the collapse of the complete slavery exploitation system. For several decades already, we have an animal rights movement. What benefit has it brought to the animals so far? All improvements for animals have been achieved by people who accepted intermediate steps to reach their goals. Some examples here: ban of battery cages for chickens, ban of wild animals in circus, prohibition of crates for zoos, prohibition of the castration of piglets without anesthesia. It is true that all this does not yet fundamentally change the present cruel system of exploitation, but it definitely is already preventing much animal suffering today and is also initiating public debates about our treatment of animals. Moreover, each single campaign for animals creates increased general awareness about the problem of human-animal relations and achieves more than philosophical discussions in the ivory tower, which is only of interest of those in it. We need to work patiently and persistently without presuming that everyone will have gone vegan tomorrow. Experience shows that such expectations is completely unrealistic and that the claim all or nothing is blocking a lot of improvements which are possible today. Compromising and interim steps are necessary, as the example of woman emancipation has demonstrated. Let's use everything which can bring us closer to our goal. Animals don't ask why they are not tortured. It is of no interest to them whether their lives are spared with the help of a certain animal rights philosophy or for environmental or health reasons. Some people can successfully be guided towards a vegan lifestyle by explaining animal rights. Others are more interested in their own health, and there are also those who consider the environmental damages of animal production as their primary reason to stop the consumption of animal products. Only solid, objective, and persistent information about the terrible practice of animal farming will create public awareness and consequently help to build a lobby group from all walks of life and strong enough to bring the needed fundamental changes in society and politics. Of course, also all other activities in the interest of the animals are just as useful, and the more people are getting involved, the better. Not helpful at all is vegan criticizing vegetarians and welfarists condemning animal rights activists. Campaigns launched and represented on a broad basis can bring more success than individual initiatives. Uniting against the suffering of animals is easy and drives prices up, which in turn slows the consumption of meat and dairy products. We have to witness so much animal misery that we should at least try to find positive aspects in the work of others and support any of their initiatives leading in the right direction. With this in mind and for the sake of the animals, I'm hoping for many small and larger steps bringing us closer to our goal, because the animal needs us now. Get active, join large organizations, and unite. We are getting closer to our goal step by step. Thanks for your interest.